Welcome, everybody. Buenos dias. Good morning. How's everybody feeling? Yes? Yes?
Try that one more time. One more time.
I know, man. How's everybody doing today? Good. Okay, from on a scale from like zero, as in like no energy, I should be in my bed right now. I'm not even paying attention to you. To 10, like I'm hella juice. I'm here, and thank you for being here with us. Where are you? Show with your fingers. Just tell us, like, I'm at 1, I'm at 4, I'm at 5, I'm at 6.
Somebody's
I'm
at 20 right now.
Dang, I'm flashing 10s. What? Okay, where's everybody at? Let me see.
Well, I like it.
Dang.
That's the type of energy we need today.
That's what contagious. I'm talking about.
That's contagious. We need that energy.
Okay, y'all. So, what we're going to do today is, we're going to introduce ourselves to y'all to let you know who we are, why we're up here, right? How we're going to have this plática. And then we're gonna go into the conversation about undocumented students in pre-health and pre-med journeys, specifically with what's going on with folks at the undergraduate level, and then starting to prepare and cultivate the soil so that you can bear the fruits of your professional career in the future. Does that make sense to y'all? I come from a huge like farm working background, so I make a lot of nature resource analogies, whatever they're called. So if at any point in time you don't get something, raise your hand and be like, yo, break that down. What do you mean? What do you mean we need to cultivate the soil? What does that mean? Is that good? So we'll get into it. So I'm gonna let Nohemy introduce herself. You wanna come to the mic? Nohemy, Meng, and I, and then I'll kick us off in the first one. Meng's gonna take us to the second portion. Nohemy's gonna close it out strong. You always want women leadership to close and to heal spaces because men tend to like just mess them up, right? So you just gotta trust them. So let's go.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Nohemy Chavez. I'm a counselor for the Undocumented Student Program at UC Berkeley. I'm UC Davis alum, so I'm happy to be back at my alma mater.
Hey.
And I got my master's at Sacramento State in counseling. So I will be presenting on how you can be an advocate for yourself and how you can find advocates.
Good morning, everybody. Super excited to be here today. My name is Meng So, and I'm the director of the Undocumented Student Program at UC Berkeley. And it's so amazing to be here because this room in itself, it's groundbreaking. When I look across this room, I'm seeing the future doctors of America and how we can create this pipeline, particularly for undocumented students. Today, along with Nohemy and Ruben, I'll be talking about how you can finance your graduate school education if you decide to pursue pre-health or pre-medicine.
Yeah, and good morning, everyone. My name is Ruben Elias. I am the coordinator of research and mobilization projects for the Undocumented Student Program. And then we also work in a larger component called the Centers for Educational Equity and Excellence at UC Berkeley. We work with different equity populations from the undocumented, first generation, low income, veterans, student parents meaning folks who have children and are going to school, all that good stuff, and independent students, foster care students, and then the reentry population, which is folks that are 25 and older trying to get their education. So we work with like a whole bunch of familia. That's where we come from. What I'm gonna start us off today is answering the elephant in the room conversation about whether or not it's possible to actually pursue a career in the medical field or in the health field as an undocumented person, as a pre-documented person, as a documented person, so on and so forth. And we're gonna get into what that is. Are we good? Are we feeling this? Yes. We do great with body language, so we see you smiling, we're gonna keep going. If we don't see you smiling, we're not going anywhere. I'm just kidding. Okay, so first and foremost, it's important for us to let you know from the very get-go. Up here in the screen right now, what you're seeing is a few of the medical schools that one way or another have either already admitted an undocumented student, are in the process of working out their admissions language to invite this population to be part of the application process. Folks that have graduated from this medical schools. And I also wanna let you all know, so you don't start like going crazy with your pens, all of this is gonna be made available to you all on a website, okay? And I'm gonna let you all know exactly where to go. I see you all like
putting the pens down.
Yeah, with both hands. It's important for us to show you this because sometimes in our minds and sometimes in the communities that we're around, we get a lot of no's. Do you understand what I'm saying? We get a lot of doubt. We get a lot of folks telling us, actually, that's impossible what you're trying to do. Or I've never heard of an undocumented person going. And it doesn't matter if it's a Latino, a black student, a Muslim student, a Christian student, whoever could be telling you, it's not about those multiple identities. An undocumented context is a legal conversation. Undocumented people come from all walks of life, from all around the world. At UC Berkeley alone, our students represent over 24 different countries around the world. Do you see what I'm saying? So this, I'm speaking to everybody. Is it possible? Yes, it is. You don't want to believe Ruben? Look at the screen. Those are the medical schools that we are currently in, that we've been at, or that are in conversation about supporting our students. Are we good, y'all? Is this real? Do we feel like this is real? This is a real conversation? You want to pay attention all of a sudden? Yes, that's what I'm talking about. Okay, so second, there's two different tracks ever since deferred action for childhood arrivals came into play. DACA. Is everyone familiar with that language? So on and so forth. If not, come to our website. We can break it down for y'all. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to break down what happens for a DACA-mented person and for a non-DACA-mented person. Is that good? Are we comfortable with that language? Okay. So first, and I'm going a little bit fast because we don't have that much time. I would love for us to have a two-hour session to really massage things in. It's important for us to just to cover these things for y'all, introduce y'all, and then we can follow up after this workshop one-on-one. You can get in contact with us, and we can even get you in contact with some folks that are doing it big. Is that good? This is just an welcoming invitation to the familia that you just became a part of. Are we good? Can we get some smiles about that? You're not alone, y'all. Good. Hella cheesing. Somebody brushed their teeth today. All right. So what's going on as of right now? And it's important for me to use the language of right now because every single day we're part of efforts that are cultivating the soil so that it becomes a stronger yes. Is that good with everybody? So there is a stronger case in terms of admissions just for the simple fact that folks can understand where you are in your legal status and they know how they can provide funding for you. Do you understand what I'm saying? That has nothing to do with your caliber, with your talent, so on and so forth. It just makes sense to the institution to say, yes, we're going to let you in because we know that you qualify for some form of financial support. And then we're going to break into the second. Now, financial aid specifically, stronger case, but currently same boat whether you will have DACA or not. Why? Because DACA does not seem to make a difference as of now. What does that mean? After you get the admission stage, after they say yes to you, and then they're having considerations about admissions, it's equally as difficult for schools to try to figure out how to fund for you to be at the medical school level. And that's when it becomes a hustle. Can everybody say hustle with me? One, two, three.
Hustle.
One, two, three.
Hustle.
One, two, three.
Hustle.
Yo, have you heard that song? No? Damn it. It's okay. I love that song. So you got to hustle, you got to hustle, you got to hustle, and you got to hustle even harder. Okay, there's some folks that have phenomenal experiences where they went into a bank and they said, look, here's my acceptance into Santa Clara Medical School, into UCLA Medical School. All I need is for you to give me $200,000 for me to pay this off. And then when I become a doctor, guess what? I'm going to have more than enough money to be lawful and loyal to my loans. I'm going to pay those off. I just need you to believe in me right now because I see your family pictures. I want to be a pediatrician. Your kids can come to me in a few years. And they're like, whoa, that's impressive. You know what? Here's a $200,000. That's one case. Another case that have been like people just do community like POTS, right? Where they go to a local business, they go to another business, tío, tía, they start like a little WePay account online and folks just start donating and then they make their way through to be able to finance their education. Welcome, welcome. Come in.
Come on.
Now, residency. For residency, it's a big yes. Is everybody familiar with the conversation about residency and what residency is in terms of the medical field? Beautiful, yes. So residency is a lot easier for somebody who has DACA, and that's no longer a challenge anymore. You got in, you're getting financed, you're doing all your tests. It's time for your stage of residency, and because you're documented, you go straight through. Does that make sense? There is no challenge there. Anybody who's telling you right now that documented people cannot get residency, and that's why you should not go to medical school, what are you going to tell them? They're wrong. Say, hey, actually, Ruben said that it's cool. And if you need a website, go to Pre-Health Dreamers, and it says right there, clearly stated that, yes, you can. Is that cool? Are we clear with that? Everybody on the same page? Whoa, we just got legends walked into this room. So now, the last thing is physician's license. In California, yes, a documented person has no issues in terms of physician's licenses. And now for other states, it's on an everyday basis. Remember how I told you that every day we're cultivating the soil, we're having conversations with folks? Let me be honest with you all. Sometimes it's a conversation that needs to happen with different schools because of the fact that most folks are very new to this conversation about DACA. They themselves are trying to figure out what they can and cannot do because it's such a new law. Do you understand what I'm saying? Is everybody there? Remember, it takes humongous amount of efforts and time for a law to go into place. And it takes just as much, if not more, for people to understand how to apply that law into whatever they're in. And until they don't have a case that specifically challenges them to do so, most likely people are just too busy. You see what I'm saying? So sometimes we have to take that trailblazing attitude to say, let me be the first one that's gonna do that for you and change the entire landscape of this institution so that I can open up that door so more folks can come after me. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's kind of like, how many of you are first generation college students? First generation, raise your hand, put your hands out. Same for me, right? I'm a first generation college student. Now in my community, they can't say, well, folks from Calexico don't go to college. Do you see what I'm saying? So now moms are talking to my mom, my sister's also in college, so now the door has been opened and the conversation becomes, how do we get there, as opposed to, what the hell is college? Do you see what I'm saying? Very different. Same thing with this conversation. Now let's take it to the other side, the non-DACA track, okay? In terms of admissions, there needs to be a stronger case built for you to be able to tell the admissions officers kind of where you are. We don't want to tell you whether you should or should not disclaim that you're undocumented. That is up to you all. That is all on you all to say what's your comfortability. We understand that for some folks, they themselves haven't shared to anybody, right? Much less how you're going to do to an admissions. If you're able to do so in such a way that your life experience lets the admissions folks know that it's built and created abilities to overcome challenges, you can say that to them. Have all of you heard about don't do like the violin sob story or whatever? That's the references that a lot of folks do. Just do it in a way that it's a point of strength. Do you see what I'm saying? In terms of admissions. Now, financial. Mostly treated as international students once you're in the medical school, which makes you ineligible for federal aid and subsidized loans specifically, must rely on private loans and scholarships. And remember, all of this is going to be made available to you all. It becomes a little bit of a hustle. Looking into private loans, what private loans qualify for you, and the secret mantra of the H word. What's the H word? We just did it like three times. Hustle. Yes. You got to turn on your hustle gears. You got to be ready to start having conversations and get real comfortable and say, hey, look, this is my admissions into medical school. Let's have a conversation about how we make this happen because I'm just trying to save some lives. Literally. You see what I'm saying? That's not like a joke. You can smile because you're a badass that you can change lives and save lives in the future. But just let them know. Get comfortable with knowing that you got to hustle a little bit. Now, residency. Unfortunately, at this time, it's a no. Okay? There is no work authorization for non-DACA folks. And again, at this time, there's still conversations that are going on. But remember, residency comes in the future process. Right now, you can still be working hard to get into what you need to get to, your medical requirements, your postdocs, get into medical school, do the medical school work that needs to happen, and then we'll cross that bridge when we get there. Comprehensive immigration reform is a national conversation. Is everybody familiar with that? Everybody knows what I'm talking about? So there's different statuses of what's going on. We never know what's going to happen. Just last week, a whole bunch of national leaders got arrested to protest about how a lot of the conversation on immigration all of a sudden got put off the table and they want to put it on back on. It's a lucha. It's a struggle. But we're in that struggle every single day. And we need you all to be equally committed because it's a lot easier for our leadership to say, hey, I got these students. What's your name? Favi, I got Favi that's ready to go to medical school. You're wasting time. That's a community that needs a doctor right now because in Favi communities, there's only clinics. There's no hospitals. And Favi's ready to go open up a hospital right now. Do you see what I'm saying? That is a much stronger statement than we think there's some folks that want to go to medical school. All of a sudden, Favi shows up hella fierce and says, yuck, y'all are messing up. I'm trying to open up this hospital. You're literally killing lives. I'm trying to save lives. Let's meet in the middle. We good? Everybody good? We feeling this? Yes, beautiful. Now, physician license, same thing. There's no work authorization because you need a social security number for this specific context. Same thing with what I just said. Move on to the next one. Okay, now, obstacles. In terms of the application for MCAS, MCAT, it's just finances for medical education. Let's zoom in a little bit because the screen is a little bit smaller. No, you can see that. Y'all can't really see that, right? Yeah, because I'm having a hard time. Let's do a little by little. Remember I told y'all to be ready to zoom in? That's what I was talking about. Okay, so now, medical education in terms of admissions eligibility, U.S. citizens or permanent residents, and then funding and clinical rotations from years 3 to 4. Right? Those are some of the obstacles that we can start anticipating. We told you we're going to be really blunt and transparent, remember? We'd rather give you the context of what's going on as opposed to kind of sugarcoat stuff, and then you show up and you find out that the sugar doesn't taste that good. I like that one. Cool. Residency programs in terms of DACA, And the last thing is license to practice in California is a yes. But if California is a yes, then we know other states now have something to point to and say, well, why is California doing it and we're not? That's the conversations that we want Texas to start having, for Oregon to start having, and all of these different states that have showed some type of commitment to the dreamer population. Are y'all familiar with the dream language, right? Every single day we're in conversation with different folks. There's also, again, I want to repeat, the Pre-Health Dreamers organization that is literally having conversations almost every single week with different deans, with different staffs, with financial aid options, so on and so forth, and they're building a whole tool of resources for you all to be able to say, I can go to one place and get as many of my questions answered. And if your questions are not answered in that space, you can follow up with them and get direct responses from them. And we're gonna give you the information a little bit later in the conversation. So this is in terms of the portion of is it possible, is it not possible to go to medical school? And what can I start anticipating in terms of what's gonna happen to me along that process? So now we hit the point of like, okay, I understand that it is possible, that there's multiple tracks that somebody can be on in the context of our needs. Come in, come in. You can come in, of course. We would never say no to anybody. Come in, this is familia. You can get over there, you can stay right there. Yeah, there's a seat right here, look, right here, front row. So now what I'm gonna hand it over to, I'm gonna hand it over to Meng, and Meng's gonna answer the money conversation, right? Because that's where everybody always goes. At least that's where my mama went. Oh, congratulations, you got into Berkeley. ¿Cuánto nos va a costar? How much is it gonna be? You know what I'm saying? So let's answer that question before we even get there. Y'all ready? All right, so I'm gonna give it up to Meng. Oh,
perfect. Before we actually get into the money conversation, I want to ask you guys a couple of questions. By a show of hands, how many of you are thinking about or want to become a doctor, physician, or nurse in the future? By a show of hands. All right, for everyone who put their hands up, how many times have you been told no in your life, that you can't become a doctor, that you can't become a physician, right, because of your legal status? Today, no is the first opportunity to say yes to yourself. And today we're gonna talk about how you can pay for your medical school tuition. And so how we think about financing your education is two categories, right? One is to think about the public schools, two is to think about private schools, and being able to look at the political temperature check of the state that you're looking to attend medical school in, right? And so at this graph is, it breaks down the characteristics, private and public. And what this tells you is that private universities accept undocumented students, right? Private universities, because they have private endowments, are more likely to be able to offer you a wider range of tuition, scholarships, loans, et cetera, right? When you break it down, private institutions offer private scholarships, public, not as much, right? You go down even more, private, yes, public, no. In California, California is a dream state, right? So when you're thinking about going to medical school, it's important to do research on what the political landscape of that state is for immigration and for undocumented students, right? Does anyone know what AB 540 is? For someone who said yes, can you tell me what it is?
It's the students that graduate from high school and have been here for, that spend 3 years of high school here, they graduate from high school, and then they have to fit other requirements, but it's the students in California that go to college.
Exactly. So you hit the nail on the head. So AB 540 grants both residents and undocumented students access to in-state tuition. Recently, California was able to pass the California Dream Act, which allowed for undocumented students to not only get in-state tuition, but to get what? In-state aid. Right, so now undocumented students are able to benefit from state grants and private institutional grants. And that's really important to keep in mind, because not every state is like California and is able to offer students scholarships, grants, et cetera, et cetera. And so if you're thinking about going to medical school and you qualify for AB 540, it may be a first step to consider California medical schools as an option, right? Secondly, oftentimes because different medical schools don't know how to handle or treat undocumented students, they may oftentimes get classified as international students, right? Does that make sense? And sometimes if you get classified as an international student, international students are very similar to undocumented students in the sense that they're not able to benefit from federal financial aid, FAFSA. Does anyone know what the cost of medical school is on average for a private university versus a public university? Yeah, so for a private university, it's about $260,000. Who has that in their pockets right now? No, if you did, you have to share it with everybody, right? And for a public university, it's about $160,000, right? And so the big elephant in the room, the big question that we have for ourselves, oftentimes being first generation, being low income, is how am I gonna pay for college after I get in, right? And that's what the Pre-Health Dreamers Network is doing. They're a network of alumni students, current medical students, who are putting together best practices in terms of how students can navigate the cost of attending medical school, right? And there's a couple ways you could think about it. There's scholarships, private loans, and loan repayment, right? So scholarships. First, to start off, what institutional scholarships are available to incoming undocumented students based off merit and based off need, right? What's merit-based scholarships? GPA, extracurricular activities, letter of recommendations, kind of the holistic kind of overview of that, right? What's need-based scholarships? Right. So if you have financial need, if you're low income, you qualify for certain scholarships based off that income, right? For a lot of undocumented students, because they don't qualify for FAFSA, they're not able to determine what their financial need is. And so what we really recommend for you to do is to speak with the financial aid counselor at that respective institution that you plan on going to help calculate your need so you're still eligible for those scholarships, right? And then there's outside scholarships from a medical school, right? So doing your research, have you guys heard of E4FC? Educators for Fair Consideration. They have a comprehensive scholarship list guide that tells you what scholarships that are open to undocumented students. These are just a handful of scholarships that the Pre-Health Dreamers have constructed that are open to undocumented students that are applicable and translatable to medical school, right? The Tylenol Scholarship, the National Professional Scholarship, the New American Scholarship, right? So before you even apply to medical school, do your research about what scholarships are open to you that you could take and that are portable to the schools that you want to attend in the future.
So do scholarships exist for y'all? Yes or no? So whenever it tells you, actually, there's no scholarships, what are you going to say? Yeah. It's a point for y'all to start practicing because those conversations are going to happen. You understand what I'm saying? So now you have a point directly to go to.
Yeah. And funding medical school is a challenge for undocumented students. It's even more challenging for undocumented students, right? And that's what we go to the private loan conversation, right? Being able to take out loans for education because you're not eligible for federal financial aid, not eligible for a direct loan, unsubsidized loans. And these banks right here, Citibank, Sallie Mae Bank, Citizens Bank, have all a credible history in providing undocumented students loans to be able to pay off that $260,000 if you go to a private university or that $160,000 if you go to a public university, right? And loans oftentimes become a taboo, right? How many students here fear loans? I know I did. It's okay, right? Loans are oftentimes a taboo, but think about it like this. Loans are an investment, right? Loans are an investment in yourself. When you buy a car and you take that car off the lot, that car does what in value? Depreciates. But what happens when you invest in yourself? What happens when you invest in your education, right? Once you get that medical degree, once you become a nurse, once you become a physician, your value only goes what? Skyrockets up, right? So that's what loans are. It gives you the opportunity to fulfill whatever dreams you have, right, in the medical field. And then there's loan repayment. And this is through a private organization where you're able to take out loans and work out a structured repayment process and work out the interest rate on that, right? And so this is just a brief conversation. We'll go a little bit more into financial aid if you guys have additional questions. Over here, if you go to this map, Ruben, this is a temperature check of what's going on in the nation, right? All these states right here that are green offer in-state tuition for undocumented students and in-state aid, right? Some of these states that are in red are what?
Good job.
I like that. Those states need a little bit more work, right? They're not the most politically conscious towards undocumented students. They don't recognize the talent that we're able to bring to their states, right? And that's why it's important to do your temperature check, to do your research before applying, because what use is it to apply to a state like Alabama if Alabama is saying, hey, we don't accept undocumented students? Well, everyone in this room is talented. Everyone in this room has the opportunity to contribute. Everyone in this room is the future doctor of America. You're going to save a life. You're going to give birth to a new child, right? So go somewhere that's willing to accept you, that's willing to support you, because you're going to pay that support. You're going to pay it forward back to the country 10 times over again.
Yeah, this is a conversation that we want to make sure that we have with you all. Now that we've gone from the admissions portion, is it possible? Is it real? Because honestly, sometimes some of us have come from communities where it's really believed that it's not real to pursue those kinds of dreams. You see what I'm saying? There's some places that we come from sometimes where actually sharing our dreams is antagonistic of making those dreams happen because everybody keeps telling you how you're crazy. Well, that's loco. Like, what are you talking about? Like a doctor. Doctors are, you know, this, and that's not what we are and all those kinds of things. So now we clarified that. Now we've gone into money. The money question is being answered on an every single day basis, and there's multiple ways to answer that question. So what you want to believe after here, because it's the truth, is that there's different options for you. Mm. And every single day, there's a new option that's going to kind of start coming out because of folks like Pre-Health Dreamers, because of teams that are out there that are in those trenches that are saying, yo, we benefit from having more doctors in these communities. How can you not invest into that, right? And sometimes those people that question you sometimes are your families, and they're not coming from a place of them not believing you. It's true, pure fear. You see what I'm saying? It's the fear of like, I don't want my son or my daughter to be in a place where it's out of my hands. I don't know what's going to happen to you. Do you know what I'm saying? I know when I told my mom I want to go to Berkeley, her thing was like, oh, está bien lejos. You know, like, it's super far. You know, what if something happens to me? And I was like, damn, what if something happens to my mom? What if something happens to my sister? What if something happens to you? Like, who's going to cook you that sopita and stuff? Like, damn, sopita's bomb. You know, and like, I started asking myself, you know, should I go and all that good stuff? But then I asked her, well, you went from Chihuahua to Mexico City to study at UNAM. Why can't I do that here in the States if it's going to be the same thing? And that's when it clicked for her, right? Like, it's time to let kind of like the bird fly. It's time for you to let yourselves fly. You got to know, trust in your wings. You got to make your parents trust in your wings. If you have parents, and you have to be able to know that there's somewhere for you to land, because there's familia everywhere. Even in this red states, there's so much love there at the people familia level. Mm. We're just working with the institutions. It takes a little bit longer for them. You know what I'm saying? So now we're going to go into advocacy.
And I think one more thing just to add to that, no is never a final answer. No just means not right now.
Yep.
Right? Think about the landscape of California 5 years ago, 10 years ago, where we didn't have AB 540, when we didn't have the California Dream Act, right? No just means not right now. And oftentimes, as undocumented students, what one of my colleagues, Angel, likes to say is, you can walk the path that's been paved, or you can pave a new path as you walk it. Does that make sense? And a lot of you, when you go to medical school, when you go to undergraduate school, you guys are going to be trailblazers. You guys are going to bring pioneers. You may be the first undocumented medical student that UCSF has, right? You may be the first, but you won't be the last. Because when you walk through that door, you're going to keep that door open so other undocumented students can walk through it right after you.
Yeah. And know the beauty of that is whenever you go to that institution, because we have undocumented students right now at UCSF. And then when an undocumented student contacts UCSF and says, hey, I really want to go to the school, you know what they say? They contact that student and says, hey, somebody else wants to come in here. I think you're the best person for them to talk to, not us. And that's exactly what we want to happen. Because it's completely different for you to be dealing with a brother or with a sister that's going through the same struggle than to go to an institution that really has no idea how to work with you. And most of the time, because of that, they're going to say, I don't think so. But then you have somebody who's going through and says, hell yeah, I think so. Actually, you can be my roommate next year because my roommate's going to move out and I need you here. Do you see what I'm saying? That's what we're talking about. So now we're going to go into advocacy. And this is where Nohemy's going to take it over, because she is like the queen of knowing how to be able to really advocate for yourself and make things happen. Remember I told you something, you just got to let women take over? That is the best person to do that, right? So take it away, Nohemy.
Thank you, Ruben. So I'm going to stay put right here for the mic, but let me know if I'm not loud enough. So as Ruben and Meng mentioned, another really important part besides being able to pay for it, besides being able to know where is it safe for you to go, another important part is learning how to advocate for yourself and for learning how to get advocates to advocate for you, because you will get that no. But just as Meng said, it's always a no, not right now, but that doesn't mean that you can't change someone's mind. And so how do you do that? So by a show of hands, how many of you have gotten to where you are right now because another person helped you get here? Okay. So I think most people in the room. And so you can consider that person that helped you get here, person or probably more than one, you can consider that person an advocate and also an ally. And so the difference between an advocate and an ally is that an ally might have a deeper understanding about the context of where undocumented students are. And so some of the things that I'm going to talk about today is how to prepare yourself to get to that medical school application process, how to go through the medical school application process, and what to do once you're there. So some of the things that I'm going to talk about is internships. One of the groups that we've been working a lot with, they've been our partners in crime through all of this, is the Pre-Health Dreamers group. And the sign-in sheet that was going around, please feel free to also check the box so that they can contact you afterwards. They have a wide array of resources. So one of the things that gets asked a lot is, well, how can I do an internship if maybe I don't have DACA yet? how can I get an internship if the application says only U.S. citizens or permanent residents, right? It never hurts to ask. Never hurts to make an anonymous phone call and just double check. Things that are funded by federal money are often very strict, and they will very specifically state this is only for U.S. citizens or permanent residents. And that's okay. But there's a lot of other opportunities, internships, volunteer opportunities that are paid perhaps through a stipend or that come from outside money, private money. And those are definitely things that you can advocate for yourself for to be able to get. In terms of background checks, we've done a little research with the Pre-Health Dreamers group. Internships often require that you get a background check, right? Because you're working with other people. Most of the times you're able to get a background check with just showing a photo ID without having to have documentation. So that's also something else that you can explore. Internships as well can be things that you maybe didn't really consider, right? So when I talk about advocating for yourself, maybe there's a clinic in your hometown. Maybe there's an organization that maybe translate medical documents for other people, and that's something that you can help with. It doesn't have to be something as strict as I'm at a hospital and I'm working with patients. Try to think creatively in terms of how you can get your foot in the door and how you can start making those networks. Talking about making opportunities for yourself. So just as I mentioned earlier, maybe there isn't an internship that you may be qualified for, or maybe there's an internship that didn't accept you. That doesn't mean that you can't create opportunities for yourself. So as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of national groups, there's a lot of professional organizations that are willing to take on interns. Whenever you say free labor, people love free labor. So if you mention that you're willing to volunteer, you'd be surprised how many doors are going to open for you. And so again, being creative and building up your portfolio. And that portfolio is not just a resume and cover letter. How many here have a LinkedIn account, an updated LinkedIn account? 3, maybe 4. We have some work to do. So those of you that are not familiar with LinkedIn, think about it as the professional Facebook. Okay, this is a chance for you to display your professional and educational background in a professional setting. Okay, this is a chance for you to kindly stalk other people, such as doctors maybe in the field, people that are in these professional organizations. This is a chance for you to connect with other professionals and show them what you can do. Okay, this is a safe space for you to be able to connect with somebody because your profile is not going to say your legal status. Okay, so LinkedIn is very important. Use it as a tool to be able to build up your portfolio. And that just zoomed in. Sorry about that. So once you have your portfolio built up as an undergrad, you'll start to think about applications. And applications cost a lot of money, so it's something that you're going to want to save up for. But to help you with those applications, you'll definitely need to be an advocate for yourself and call these schools specifically, because every school is going to have a different application. They're going to have different rules. They're going to have different ways of filling it out. And so you'll need to take the time to do your research and to call every school individually. If you call admissions and admissions is not being helpful, it's not the end all be all. Okay, there's other offices that you can call until you find the right person that's willing to get those answers for you. One great place that you can call is the Office of Graduate Diversity. So almost every school has an Office of Graduate Diversity. And if they're not able to get those answers for you, see them as a liaison to be able to get those answers for you. One of the other suggestions that we give to students is that you turn in those applications early. It's very important that you turn them in early as opposed to waiting until the deadline of the application. Reason being is that if you turn in your application early, it gives the admissions the time to be able to accommodate how they're going to bring you into their school. There might be a document missing. They might have to investigate with financial aid how things are going to play out. And if you turn it in early, you don't run the risk of later being told, well, we still need this form from you and it's too late now. So notice the importance of time. Time is very sensitive. Letters of recommendation are going to be required for every application. So who here can easily think about 3 people that can write a letter of recommendation for you? Okay. And who do you think those letters of recommendation should come from? Professors. Professors? Mm-hmm. Should they only be from professors? Mentors, yes. What type of mentor? Based on your profession, or the profession you're pursuing. Who else can maybe write letters of recommendation for you? Counselors, yes, I heard that in the back. Attorneys, Oh, employers, okay, yes. Employers, yes, thank you. So it's advisable for students to get a mix of letters of recommendation and not just faculty. Most schools will probably ask for three. That's kind of the magic number for most graduate programs. And so you'll want to make sure that you get a combination of letters of rec, not just from faculty, but also from employers, from maybe supervisors, from mentors, people that know what you can do and that can really support you and talk highly of you in that letter. And it's important that that person has credibility, whether they have maybe a professional degree, they're very known in the community. So you want to make sure that you get a mix of these letters of rec. Finding advocates. So networking can be a little bit scary. A lot of students get intimidated in talking to professionals and talking to faculty members. And a lot of the times, you're not sure if it's safe to disclose, right? It's maybe not you're wanting to disclose. We've also heard of students that have disclosed and they didn't get a positive reaction. And that can very well happen. So one of the things that we suggest is that if you're iffy about a person, if you're not sure if they're going to support you, if they're maybe the right person to talk to, sometimes it's advisable to go through a trusted ally. So you can maybe talk to a professor that you're very close to and say, I'm wanting to connect with this professor, but I'm not sure if they're going to support me. You want to have a liaison that's going to connect you, right? One of the other things is when you go to conferences like today's conference, make sure you get business cards. Make sure you engage in conversations because talking in person is very different from you sending somebody, a total stranger, an email, right? If they see you in person, if they get to meet you in person, they're going to have a different impression of you as opposed to just getting an email from somebody they've never heard of. So when you go to these conferences, when you go to these health fairs, make sure that you gather the strength and the energy to go up to somebody, to shake their hand, to tell them your story, right? Because in telling them your story, maybe they don't know how they can help you, but they might know somebody, right, that they can connect you with. And so as you're getting those business cards, it's really important that you take the time right very soon afterwards to turn it around and write down on that card where you met that person. Maybe some of the things that you maybe talked about. Maybe you talked about your love for dogs. Maybe he talked about having a bike. And then also write down what they looked like. Give a brief description because you're going to get so many business cards that you'll later find yourself saying, where did I meet this person? I don't remember where I met this person. I don't remember what he or she did. And so if you have a description on the back of the card, you're able to follow up with them a few days after when you met them and, you know, send them an email and say, hi, you know, I'm so-and-so. I met you at the pre-health pre-med conference at UC Davis. We were talking about how we're really interested in motorcycles. I just wanted to follow up with you and see if you can connect me with somebody at this hospital or at this medical school or what have you. That importance of following up and adding them on LinkedIn so that they have your profile already, they know what you're up to, and it's a way for you to establish that network. Does that make sense? Okay. And again, allies. So promoting allyship is very important. There's a lot of people who want to help, they want to support, they just don't know how. Right? So becoming a part of a student group, becoming a part of an organization, asking them for an informational interview, those are all different ways that you can promote allyship by telling them about your story, letting them know about your situation, letting them know how they can support because of their privilege, because of their position. Bless you. So those are just some of the things that you can do because as Ruben mentioned, it's going to be a hustle. It always is. Your entire college pipeline will be a hustle. But you hustling for yourself is going to be a lot harder if you don't have people to support you, right? You have to create that support network. It has to include perhaps family, perhaps friends, students that are maybe going through the same process as you. And so part of that is advocating for yourself, but also finding people to advocate for you.
So what we wanna do, how are we feeling? Are we good? Yes? Is this helpful so far? All right, this is just a warm-up. No, I'm just kidding. We're almost out of time. So what I want to show you all is I want to say one thing, and I'm going to show you another thing, and then I want to open into like a community plática, a community-like conversation. Okay, we want to welcome your questions to give you specific answers. If it's super detailed, we're going to follow up with you after the session so we can get as many questions as possible. Does that make sense? And there's multiple people in the space that are allies, that are professionals in the field, that you can get our contact information after this, and we can start a conversation that can really lead us into the next stage. So the one thing that I want to say is, what's next, right? What do you do after you've been giving all of the information from today, and it takes you to the point of, okay, now I've been able to... remember, I'm telling you that this is all going to be made available to you all. These are places that you can go to, and there's always going to be answers for you. If not, there's going to be contact information where you can follow up and get that from them. This is all going to be made available to you all. Just make sure to go to phdreamers.org, graduation reaching a dream deferred, the undocumented student program, and educators for fair consideration. All of these websites are go-to websites. I'm happy that I'm seeing some of y'all smile. You're not writing anything down because you already have them. Congratulations. Thank you. Look at their faces. They're smiling. That's a good sign. It makes it works. Everybody else, please make sure to get on that. When you go to Pre-Health Dreamers, okay, you're going to find something that I wish existed when I was back in middle school and in high school, not so much for myself, but to show it to my mom, right? Because my mom was always very... worried that her being undocumented was going to impact me negatively, and that's why we were never sure what we could and could not do growing up. So what they have at Pre-Health Dreamers is what I have right here, right? And what I have right here is a Pre-Health Dreamers, pretty much like Holy Grail, Magna Carta, all that good stuff, whatever you want to call it. It's all of the major questions that at some point somebody that's a dreamer or undocumented asked themselves. So they started to record all of the responses to those questions to the point that now it's a multi-page document that talks with you, okay? It does not list, okay, not literally. He started smiling like, what? That'd be dope, like a mini movie of this. You know what I'm saying? Yes. Anyways, ideas. So what it does here, it gives you, bless you, there's questions, there's answers, and there's links for you to follow up. There's instructions about how you should carry a conversation. There's a little bit of everything. This is a multi-year project that has been going on, that's going to continue to go on, that it's always readily available, and it can be easily downloaded. Does that make sense? Are we good? Okay, the last thing that I want to say before we go into the Q&A is get comfortable with being uncomfortable because it's a process. Is that clear for everybody? Get comfortable with being uncomfortable because it's a process. I showed you all that Nohemy is a beast at advocacy, right? Nohemy walks up to anybody. It could be Obama. She'd be like, what's up? My name's Nohemy, and this is the work that I'm doing. I know you're the president, and I need us to have a conversation about X, Y, and Z. You can follow up with me if you want to talk. Outside of this classroom, I'm going to be in this tree right next door. Make sure to follow me right now. And the president just kind of goes with her. You see what I'm saying? Then there's other folks that might be a little bit shy, that it takes everything in their soul to just say hello to somebody. Make yourself know that it's a process. Today at this conference, you have the perfect opportunity to start with that hello. You have that perfect opportunity to go up to somebody and say, hey, I just went to this workshop and they told me I'm supposed to do this. So blame the workshop. It doesn't work. But my name is X, and this is the information that I need. Y, and I believe that you should believe in me because this is a little bit of my story. Can we talk? And see if it works. And if it doesn't work, there's a table right next door and try something else. Hey, you know what? This is, and just kind of keep going. Do you see what I'm saying? Is that good for everybody? Are we good? I love seeing smiles. Now we're going to go into the Q&A session. What are your questions? What are your thoughts? Maybe a suggestion that you would like to share in the space. And then we're very blessed to have folks from the Pre-Health Dreamers, and not just any folks, but the folks that have been really leading the way and paving this path to a whole new world where our folks can be going to medical school and health professions that are also here in this space in case any questions require their expertise. Is that good for everybody? So what are those questions that we have today? And when you ask, I'll repeat the question just so we can have it on camera, and then everybody gets the question and the answer. Yes?
I just have a comment that I think back to, oh, I don't know, however many years ago when gay, lesbian was such in the closet, and how much it's taken, individuals being willing to take the risk to reveal themselves and to get to be known as a person. And that you, I mean, that doing the same thing is probably, you know, it's risky and and you're trailblazing, but it is how getting to know someone as a person changes things completely. And so, like, if you were volunteering to translate in an emergency room, I mean, I know having volunteered in the hospital before, that's something that's often needed. And just then you get to know people, nurses get to know you, doctors get to know you, you know, you become a person. And so, anyway, just wanted to say.
Thank you so much for sharing that, because that's applicable for everybody, right? We can talk about the LGBTQ community. We can also talk that at some point, just having even low-income folks in the institutions wasn't welcome, right? Like, if you were poor, if you were broke or whatever, you don't belong, right? Then students of color, then we have the 60s, so on and so forth. There's always been a struggle to make sure to open up those doors for somebody. This is our struggle today, you know, supporting one another to continue. And because we know that struggle, it's so love-based that we can support other struggles in our path to that direction.
Well, this is not an issue for me, but it's one of my friends. They have an issue. Well, it's not a substantial issue. Well, they have their bachelor's degree in science, like, from another country. And then when they try to integrate it into U.S., they have to retake those courses. So it kind of wastes their time as well. Like, what would you suggest on that, like, issue? Or is there anything that schools are doing to support or...
To address that situation.
Exactly.
Yeah. So actually, there's I'll take the first stab and then I'll let them. And then if we need to go more into detail, the experts are in the back. So I know that just like we told you that there's a hustle in terms of that. There's some institutions that are very cutthroat. And for some reason, it always happens to be kind of like the higher institutions in terms of like research-based, so on and so forth, because they have this academic questioning that nobody else is preparing you the way that they prepare the students to be able to do the work that they wanted to do. It is just ego check. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of ego in that conversation. I know that for medical students, a lot of students actually return to their countries because it's easier to get into medical school there. It's more affordable, so on and so forth. And then they do the 10-year wait period to return to the U.S. if they decide to come back. And even when they come back, a lot of folks make them get reaccredited to be able to be doctors here. And that happens across the spectrum, not just in the medical fields. It actually happens in law, it happens in psychology, the certification, and a lot of it has to do with language. They wanna make sure that you have the language proficiency, and the next part is the legality context, right? That you know what you're legally abiding to, so on and so forth, according to the profession. Some of those things are non-negotiable, because there's certifications about liabilities. You know, a lot of folks are risk adverse, where like the institution wants to make sure that if they hire you, that you know how you're gonna get somebody sued and that you don't do that. So that's where that comes from. Did you wanna add to that?
I think with Dakota, I think it's a two-way street. Sometimes when you come here with a degree from a different country, that degree is not acceptable or translatable because it's not based off the U.S. educational metric system, right? Mm-hmm. Whether that be our parents, right? So if you had a parent who got their BA at a university in Mexico, in UNAM, and came here, it's not applicable, what are they supposed to do, right? And I think it's a two-way street. A lot of times what folks will do is, because the options aren't as readily available here in the United States, they'll consider going back to their home country or other countries that are more willing and more open and more welcoming to embracing migrants and undocumented students into their graduate schools, into their medical schools, so they could get their degrees, so they could get their licenses, and then reapply back to the United States after that 10-year wait period to be able to apply their degree of expertise. Yeah.
But there's been some people that go to war with those institutions and say, no, I need you to give me an exam, or I need you to give me a case study, or I need you to give me something, and let me show you what I can do. And sometimes they win them over, you know what I'm saying? Like, they're hella fierce. So that's why it's a hustle at all levels. Even when you all become doctors, it's gonna be a hustle then to do what you wanna do and to practice where you wanna practice. You know, I had a conversation last night with one of my friends who was at USC. She's currently right now applying to medical school, and she says that the main reason why she wants to apply to medical school is because she works in the Crenshaw area, and the hospital there has like no students of color, no staff of color whatsoever. And for her, that's a problem because 99% of the people to go to that place are of color. Do you see what I'm saying? And are low income. And the service is just different. Like, there's a lot of like cold energy in that space. I'm not saying everywhere, but that's what she wants to do. She says, if I have to go back to Mexico and then come back after 10 years, I know that I'm going to be doing service there and I'm going to be doing service here. By the end of the day, I'm changing lives. So it's a lot of self-talk that you have to do. Did y'all want to do something specific about that one? No? Okay. Yes.
So you know how you talked about getting loans from banks and all that for medical school? Well, I saw the banks, and just this week, I wanted to start my credit, right? Because I was thinking, well, I'm going to have to get a loan,
yes,
right? And so when I applied, I'm documented. Mm. So when I actually applied for a credit card, like at Wells Fargo, because I didn't know about these banks, like they're like, oh, you can't because your social is only valid for work. So in that case, like, well, from what you guys have talked about, I'm like, well, my option is that I can tell them, you know, like, what I am and, like, maybe find a way to, like, get over that. But then I'm like, well, if they don't accept me, then I guess I could go to these other banks. Or do I even need credit to get a loan? Or, like, how does that work?
So the question is about credit. Did everybody hear the question? And just for the camera purposes, the question is about credit and can we open a credit card and do you need a credit or a credit background to be able to qualify for loans in terms of medical school? Yes. So that's the question that we're about to answer. You want to say that? Do you want to come over here so that we get the answer?
Okay. All right, well, oh, here. Go, got it. I think I have a credit card from Bank of America, and I'm sure everyone here can help answer this question if you all have credit cards from other banks that can, anyone have a credit card? What's the bank?
I got it from US Bank. Okay. I applied for like a student credit card and I wasn't accepted.
Okay.
It was a new social, and then I tried a secured credit card, which is you just kind of like give like as much money as you can. It's a minimum $300, and it's kind of like used as credit. You could like give them $300 and they'll give it all back like after a year, so it just helps build credit. And he said like he's never seen that get rejected, and I was kind of afraid like that would be the one in a million chance.
Yeah,
but I got accepted.
And that's a secure credit card.
Yeah.
So there's gonna be different banking options, and this is where the hustle comes in, right? Because you tried one, there's hella banks. Right, that Wells Fargo messed up on you. You know what I'm saying? Like later on, Wells Fargo is gonna want you, and then you're not gonna be because you're gonna be balling. So when you go to the next bank, make sure to pay attention to what questions they're asking you. So when you go to the next bank, you already answer some of the hesitations that the first bank even gave you. Do you see what I'm saying? So rather the next conversation that you're gonna have with a bank, maybe you go straight to that secure option. Is this an option with your bank? Do you ask for 300? Do you ask for 100? I got 20 right here. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it's that hustle conversation.
I was just going to add to make sure to use, you know, your social media, like, you know, liking Educators for Fair Consideration and then posting on their page, like, hey, I want to know who's gotten a credit card from which banks. And you will get a bunch of responses because we're all here to help one another out. And, you know, and I don't want to make it seem like we have all the answers. Like, together in this room, collectively, we have knowledge that we need to share so that we can, you know, uplift one another, because this is really a struggle that we're all going through. And then for loans, so the banks that you see over there, or that were posted up, so they all have really different criteria as to how they're going to give you a loan. So some you may not need a credit history, but you need a U.S. citizen co-signer. So when you get a co-signer for a loan, that means that the person who is signing is also going to be basically, they're going to be liable for that loan. And so say, for example, you're not able to, you know, when you have to start repaying back the loan, then something happens, then the co-signer is also liable for that loan. So it all depends on the bank. So you may or may not need credit history, but I would say for all of them, you're going to have to need either a U.S. resident or citizen co-signer.
So we have time for like one more quick question, and then we're going to have to conclude, but we can follow up the conversation. This is just for the recording purposes. Did you have a question?
No, I just wanted to add, to be specific with the banker and say, just tell them, how do I build credit? Like, what do you have to offer me here that could help me build that credit? And then they can
Should I even, like, tell my bank? Because I'm thinking, I should at least maybe try to like talk to the guy about my situation and then see if they're actually going to help me or not, instead of just like, oh, give me all my money. I just want to, you know.
I think after the conversation, let's have a follow-up, a one-on-one follow-up, talk about the strategic messaging behind how you can have that conversation.
Yeah.
I think at the root of it, too, is this question of how do I establish credit history? And that's a question for loans. That's a question for being able to sign off on a lease agreement for an apartment, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
And there's this really great organization called Mission Lending Circles that works with new migrants and undocumented communities and helping to establish credit history so you take out that loan, so you can open up that credit card for the first time.
Yeah.
I think, secondly, the last thing I want to mention before we run out of time is, has anyone heard the story of Sergio Garcia?
Oh, yeah.
Sergio Garcia, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. So Sergio Garcia, and this is similar to the conversation we're having today, Sergio Garcia was an undocumented student who decided to pursue law, passed law school, took the bar, right? And the bar is the equivalent to the residency exam that you take to become a doctor, right? And the question at hand in California was, well, we have an undocumented person in the United States who's not technically supposed to be here legally. Can he legally practice law, right? Do you see that paradox?
Mm-hmm.
He took that court, he took that case to the California Supreme Court, and what happened?
Bam.
Exactly. It won, right? And so now undocumented students are able to practice law in the United States if they pass the bar just like anybody else.
In California.
In California. And that conversation that Sergio had is the conversation that we're having today in terms of how can undocumented students, one, get into medical school, two, finance medical school, and three, be able to practice once completing medical school.
So can we go? Yes, we can. Are there funding options? Yes, there is. And with your help, there's going to be even more. Does it take, what does it take? Advocacy, hustling, being able to take that responsibility to improve the path that's already been forged for us and also trailblaze new paths for one another. So that was the goal of today, for us to warm you up and introduce you to this conversation and to these options. I know we're about to go to lunch. If you have any specific questions, kind of like walk and talk with us and we can continue the conversation, and also add yourself on all of the social media so you can be part of the community. We'll pick that up. Thank you all so much for being here today. Clap it up for yourselves.
We have one more last question, comment, announcement from New.
A comment. So my name is New. I'm with Real Dreamers. We're also stably today, but really quickly, just 2 minutes, I want to share an example and a story, actually. They've mentioned a lot about having to learn to advocate for yourself, and so what that means is not taking no for an answer. So I graduated from UC Berkeley last year. I applied to summer internships in my last semester, and one of the internships I got accepted to was at Cornell Medical School, and they have an internship every summer called the Travelers Program. And I interviewed, I got accepted as regular, and then when I got the news, I was really excited, I was really happy. I was going to be living in New York for 2 months and had never been there. It's a great program. And then in the paperwork that I have to send back, they ask for a social security number, a proof of, citizenship. And then, I was flustered. I was like, wait, what's going on? But then it really took, you have to calm down. You have to think about, okay, what now, right? And so I tried to figure out my options. I went to my networks. And when I told them that I didn't have residency, they unfortunately, at the beginning, withdrew my acceptance to the program. And that was very painful and heartbreaking, but what needed to happen was that I needed to go to the networks I had established with Educators for Fair Consideration as an example of, why you need to start making your networks now. And luckily, after a month-long conversation, I was able to get connected to an alumni of Cornell, Jeff Hawkins, and so he was able to continue the conversation to really ask the school and keep it going and say, why can this really not happen? Can this student really not be in the program? And at the end of the day, they reaccepted me and it worked out. That's just an example of not taking no for an answer, and it can be so hard, and even after years of being involved and being used to telling my story, it still was just as hard to get that no, and say, no, you can't be in the program anymore. But you just have to keep going and just be creative, and there are people out there that are willing to help. So that's all. Yeah.